Welcome to Art Basel Miami Beach Salon Talks. This is a discussion between the artist Pedro Reyes, based in Mexico City, and Alex Gartenfeld, who's the new chief curator and deputy director at ICA Miami. So join us in welcoming them. And for the real diehard fans, we have some books by Pedro available on the side for after. All right, thanks.
Thank you. This one, yes, working. Thank you so much to Art Basel for all their support, to Mark Spiegler, Stephanie Reed, Mary Spirito, and Jessica Borgos for inviting us. I am Alex Gartenfeld. I'm the chief curator and deputy director at the ICA, and I am so excited to welcome Pedro Reyes and talk about his project, which is such a substantial one, at the ICA Miami in the Design District. In the way of a quick bio, Pedro is a Mexican-born and based artist living in Mexico City. He was trained as an architect. His work to this date involves sculpture, performance, video, installation. Much of his sculpture and much of all the work that he makes is about the relationship between people as inaugurated by objects, as well as the relationship between people and objects. And that was one of the many reasons that we were so excited to bring him to the museum. His work aims often to increase social awareness and collective agency about social situations, the environment, and education. After studying architecture, Pedro founded the Torre de los Vientos, an experimental project space in Mexico City, which programmed exhibitions and events in an abandoned architecture from 1996 to 2002. Together with Joseph Grima, he was the co-founder of the Urban Genome Project, which is a digital platform based on creating a sequence of the best urban practices internationally. Pedro Reyes' sanatorium, which we'll talk about today and which is hosted at the ICA Miami, is a roving project by this time, which he has called a transient clinic. For this project, he trains 25 volunteers from the local community, in whichever community he's inhabited, to enact performances, to role play treatments which have been created by the artist and in some cases created by the therapists themselves. We welcome you to the ICA in order to experience a truly individuated experience of contemporary art. Pedro's major projects include at the Guggenheim, the Walker, and the Arnolfini. We are extremely proud that the Sanatorium is one of our two exhibitions to inaugurate the ICA's first season of shows. Among those reasons are that the artist is so dedicated to challenging traditional media. As I said, the Sanatorium combines sculpture and performance in a way that cuts across boundaries of traditional media and asks all of our visitors to ask questions about what it is to be and to experience a work of contemporary art, and furthermore for his insistence that the institution, that the museum, be fully in dialogue and activated by members of the community and visitors to the museum. So without further ado, please give a round of applause for Pedro Reyes. Now the notes go down. So Pedro, in the way of beginning this project, your work is so educational, and in many regards, you account for a lot of the educational material related to your installation. This piece has a catalog, which is substantial, and which a DAP, I'm sure, is happy for me to promote to our left. It also includes a very vibrant program, which every visitor to the installation receives, and which explains each of the treatments. One of the things that's not talked about in any of this discursive material is the origins of the project or your inspiration for a clinic. And I thought maybe we could start off this discussion by you talking about your experiences of clinics and how you came to develop this piece.
Thank you very much, Alex, for the introduction. And about this first question, I think that it's true that a lot of elements from pedagogy are part of the project. I think that what I there was a point where I was taking part in many workshops through educational departments of museums and also teaching with different art schools. And I wanted to, take elements. There's a very strong tradition in Latin America of radical pedagogy from Paulo Freire in Brazil or Ivan Illich in Mexico, who were trying to combine education and social justice. And precisely they were looking at strategies to, instead of, that were very much reliant on the idea of the risk, like show the resourcefulness of the group. You know, like teaching people that they should not be dependent on a higher figure or on the figure of the specialist or the figure of authority or the figure of the teacher, but that it was up to them to have this kind of education and it, almost as a liberation process, no? That's what we don't call the idea of the pedagogy of the oppressed was very much present in Brazil and the rest of Latin America. So I was learning about all these techniques of radical pedagogy and psychology. And also I wanted to move away from technology because, you know, in the 80s and 90s and still today, there's been a lot of focus about using technology in education, which I believe that is a bad idea for several reasons. You know, the only thing that you don't need to teach a kid is how to use a computer. And if you are a teacher, you actually realize that it's a problem to give class if you have, you know, like all these the PDAs or devices that are quite distracting, no? We are permanently distracted by technology. So I was interested in finding all these kind of other objects, no, sculptures that could bring out or give shape to the conversation. Almost so the session would become a kind of ritual that was at the same time based on a horizontal relationship without the figure of the therapist as someone with credentials or someone with a specific knowledge or a specific training, but who could, that could be, there are, where the protagonist is the procedure, no? A very horizontal position where, you know, anyone can be trained to conduct the session and anyone can participate, but yet the outcome is extremely rich and also not mediated by any element of technology.
Now, a really sort of brings up a crucial and actually perhaps the only part of this installation that is unseen is the training of the volunteers when they come in and after they've signed up. They have to learn each of the 8 treatments or so treatments. Something that really struck me was your role in as much as this is a piece about role-playing during that training session. What are the types of pedagogies that you try to espouse, or what is your approach or the role that you try to adopt when you're relating to these volunteers for the first time in order to enact what is essentially a marathon 10-hour single day of training to go from volunteer to therapist?
I think that the first thing is to kill the idea of the guru. You know, so we sit in a circle, which is a different spatial situation. For instance, right now we're a kind of a typical spatial situation where there's a lot of passive people that are looking at the two of us, and we are somehow holders of a specific knowledge. No? But in the training, what we do instead is to sit in a circle, and then, you know, there's questions, no? About, you know, we do an activity, and then there's like the questions, the Q&A about how did the activity felt. But because we're sitting in a circle, instead, you know, someone asks a question, and then instead of me answering the question, any other person in the group has to answer. And that's precisely a kind of routine to show that the group in itself is resourceful, that we'll be able to solve these issues. So it's all about, you know, this is just an example of the many, many other activities that are about, You know, the thing is that, for instance, many of the therapies are combinations of existing techniques that may come from either maybe a secular version of something that may be found in religion. Like, for instance, the Xirilix is like a kind of secular version of the ritual of confession. Or the Gudu is a kind of a neutral or there are many elements of witchcraft or sorcery or shamanism that have this kind of ethnographic specificity. And you know, like, it's often common that, you know, like, you bring a shaman and the people worship him as something special. I want to end that whole idea. Also the, you know, like, the idea that there's someone who does like a PhD, etc., on psychology and or psychoanalysis, etc., that holds a specific aura of power. You know, like, I'm interested precisely in processes that are effective regardless of who's conducting them. And the idea is that in the training, basically, what we do is to show that, you know, like, that they gain certain confidence that they can conduct the process by themselves and that they will be able to improvise if something happens. And we improvise, so there's like a kind of warm-up process for them to gain some confidence. And for instance, like the sanatorium book is 70% made out of testimonials of discoveries that were done during these sessions and routines, no? So it has to do with these different ideas that that also, you know, like Ivan Illich, who wrote this book, The Schooling Society, was he was trying to point out to the idea that we should like try to find formulas for like structures to work that were not dependent on specific persons, but that could be tools that could be accessible to everyone, no? So to speak.
For me, actually, because we so often, particularly with emerging contemporary artists, we talk about actually paying contemporary artists following movements like Wage, for instance, to participate in exhibition making. So when we started working on this project, one of the things that really surprised me was your insistence on this idea of the volunteer, which now that we're almost a week into the installation, I have discovered introduces a lot of really interesting problems in terms of having them show up, being able to organize them. I was curious if in past projects you've experimented with paying any of the volunteers, or if there's anything special about this, necessarily special about the idea of a volunteer outside of their untraining.
I mean, so far it's never been like volunteers have never been paid, and for instance, like if volunteers had to be paid, this would be like a very expensive project that would limit a lot the possibility for it to be replicated, no? But often, you know, like I get a lot of feedback and, you know, like letters or testimonials, and a lot of volunteers have written, for instance, their thesis on the project, because everyone gets a research status in a way. You know, like they can always contribute with improvements to the therapies, etc. But what is most rewarding is that they get a lot from doing the work. You know, for instance, if you're doing the therapy that is a museum of life, you have someone who will arrange objects on a table as a kind of self-portrait, and you're gonna spend half hour with someone who's a total stranger, but he, you know, like as a volunteer, you experience, you know, like you visualize a map of someone's life, and by the end of the day, if you have done this 10 times, you have incorporated into your system, you know, like or you have heard like the life stories of 10 different persons, which is a privilege that is very hard to have access. I mean, we have a big number of our interactions every day are quite a very banal conversations, no? About the weather, about they're done in an automatic mode, even with our coworkers or our family members. And what the sanatorium sessions do is that, you know, like you have quite philosophical discussions, very, very intimate, with total strangers. So it's an opportunity that is very precious to you know, for the, so I think that that's the reason why volunteers have accepted to, or, you know, like that after starting working, continue doing so, because it's kind of a, also, you know, for instance, the intergenerational factor, no? We are often, you know, having conversations with people that have a certain range of age, same as ours, but all what, you know, some of the things that have, that happen in the sanatorium is that also it opens the intergenerational dialogue, because there's like therapists or that are volunteers that are very young and others that are senior, and then there's a kind of conversation between public that is also of all ranges age ranges, and I think that is also, you know, like a that, I mean, some of the ideas of this kind of social structures that are created are precisely to open to have access to these kind of exchanges that don't happen so often.
As you, one of the things that you've turned over is the ability to make therapies to some of the volunteers. What are some of your favorite of the invented therapies that have emerged from your volunteers in the past?
I mean, there's more than the one specific one. There's been improvement that some therapists have added. For instance, the gudu. The gudu is a doll that is like the kind of the positive version of the voodoo doll as it's portrayed in pop culture. You know, where you have a doll that instead of thinking someone you want to cast a spell, it's a positive spell, no? So one of the therapists said that, you know, the patient should actually like press with their fingers into each of the spots of the doll to kind of turn on the action. And it's very curious because the moment that this is done by the patient, quite often, you know, people cry. And it's it has to do with, you know, even if you are kind of using the doll as a surrogate medium to connect with that idea of a person that you're thinking of, the physical contact, you know, had that kind of added element that made it very emotional. And the question is, you know, here I believe that is because a lot of the therapies have to do with to try to move away from speech as the only basis, but to have a kind of bring out elements from ritual that we don't have access because of the kind of contemporary world we live on, and that this ritual that may involve like a physical action, may put you in touch with some feelings that you are that you're not connected with.
One of the phrases that you've used to describe the sort of experiences of encounters in this installation is quoting the psychiatrist Jacob Moreno as a surplus of reality. And I wondered if you could, it's a phrase which is both very broad and very specific and seems to trace some of these very emotional, very multifaceted responses that people have to ritual. Perhaps you could elaborate or define that phrase a little further.
Jacob Levi Moreno was a psychologist that he created psychodrama and group therapy. And he was using theater to to create a rehearsal space. No, let's say that, you know, like I have an issue with you, and I'm angry about something, and then I want to confront you, no? But I don't know how you're gonna react. So in the therapy, there's someone who's gonna play your role, and I'm gonna have this conversation, and you're gonna answer. And so that is what is called the surplus reality. It's not a fiction, and it's not a reality, but it's a kind of surrogate or the surplus extra reality that is this rehearsal space where I can test how that conversation will go. And then, so then I'm better prepared to do that the next day, you know? So the idea of surplus reality is just something that has to do with not dwelling in the past, but having access to this rehearsal space that you can, where you can fail, you can test different approaches, etc. And then you can also visualize what kind of outcome you desire. And that has to do a lot with art, because, you know, art is precisely about having these spaces where you can test things before going into the real world.
Mm-hmm. Now, one of the most important elements of theater is stagecraft. And so it was really striking to me as we were working on this installation, the extent to which you turned over some of the architecturals to us, particularly the fact that you were trained as an architect, which is a fun experience for us to sort of design this together. Now, in the installation, which takes on a very sort of generic idiom, it is sort of the construction of the sanitized white and green medical clinic. Perhaps you could talk about how the design in previous iterations of this sanatorium has impacted people's experience or movement through the work of art.
It's very interesting because, you know, I had never thought of it that there's actually like an element of stage, no? The idea of not being a real clinic but being inside these. I mean, I like very much something that Augusto Boal, who was a theater person, he had a name for something called the spect actor. So it's a spectator that becomes an actor. And what happens with the sanatorium is that, you know, as soon as you sign up into one of the therapies, you become a spect actor, no? You are taking part in this highly individualized theater situation where you are surrounded by this stage and you are suddenly given a role and you perform accordingly. No, as a patient, you will, you know, like bring out, you know, whatever personal narrative you want to deal with. And the fact is that in real, like, both hospitals and museums have some elements in common, you know, like the kind of white walls and clinical. Rational aspect of both hospitals and museums have to do with this neutrality. So, I mean, doctors perform because, you know, like so that's why they don't necessarily need the lab coat, but if they don't have one, perhaps they're carrying a stethoscope, etc. But at least some kind of object that the patient may read as so they are identified as this on their role, you know, on their persona.
When you enter the installation, how does your role change? Or perhaps if your objective is to remove the aura of the artist vis-a-vis the therapist, are there any particular roles that you feel that you're playing when you enter the installation relating to the therapists and to the patients as well?
Well, it's more that within each therapy you have to have like a kind of specific intuition, no? For instance, if you go to the philosophical casino, you have to ask a question. It works like an oracle. And the oracle, you know, like oracles are very curious, no? For instance, if you think of something as banal as Chinese cookies, when you finish having a Chinese meal and then you have the Chinese cookie, you pick a cookie and then you think that whatever is in the cookie is really meant to you. Or horoscopes, no? Horoscopes, we all know that they're bullshit, but you never read your horoscope the same as you read someone else's horoscope or someone else's sign. So same, you know, I was interested in this trick that the mind plays on you. And the fact that you have like these giant dice is that they're push and there's like this kind of magic act of pushing the dice, which is like choosing which cookie or there's something that is this random operation that nevertheless, whatever is that the answer that you're gonna get, immediately is like, you take it with a specific weight. It's like meant for you. So that philosopher's quote puts your question or dilemma under a new light. So, this is the kind of magical situations, because, you know, that's the kind of most accurate word to describe. You know, it's a kind of a magic as something that is a kind of a cognitive condition that provides a meaning that is somehow arbitrary, but that you take it extremely serious, and that you are somehow now within that framework of, you know, meaning. So each therapy has this kind of different peculiar operations.
So to sort of change aspects for a second, this is not the first time that you've done the sanatorium. It's been constructed with radical difference in different locations, including Documenta. Something that it's sort of an interesting tension for an artist like yourself who works on such vastly different projects, but who also works with sculpture, which is viewable at this fair, among others, is this issue of signature in your work. And I think that that's become a really interesting part of this sanatorium project, is the extent to which it's become an iterable franchise, almost. Perhaps you could talk about your sort of desire for the reproduction of this project, and what you would seek to achieve with that, or any problematics that might occur as a result of it.
Well, you know, it's curious because, you know, the word franchise has such a bad name, but there's like elements that I was, you know, for instance, the book, I thought of it, you know, that's why it's called the Sanatorium Operations Manual, because I looked at some manuals on how franchises operated. You know, like you have like a kind of responsibilities that have to do with what role do you play, instructions on how to run the therapies, etc. Because what I'm interested is, you know, like, it's obviously not a franchise in the sense of as a business model, because it's not a business. It's rather what you may call a social franchise. That is, you know, something that has, that is quite effective in and that you can be replicated. Where you also can like have, you know, like people that operate it without having to have like credentials or specific skills. It runs on volunteers and it runs on, you know, like a other kind of very, very basic settings, no? Sometimes, you know, my dream is for some of these works to be relevant, even if you were to put them outside the art world, you know? I mean, if you were to have this in a social context, not housed in an art institution, but, you know, in a public square, perhaps in a kind of a city where there's not an audience that has literacy about what contemporary art is, I believe it would still be meaningful and it would work kind of the same way. So that for me is, you know, like a, the, if you increase the capacity for recontextualization, so you know, like a work of art can survive even if you don't think of it as a, as art. That's what I'm interested, you know, that anyone could like really relate to it.
Which seems to me actually to bring up this issue of utopia in a way, which is a word that's bandied about a lot around your project, perhaps because of the fact that this installation, for instance, has a proclaimed sort of semi-therapeutic component. For me, the word, and I think for everyone, the word utopian is a problematic word and one that seems to express a sort of naivete of purpose or perhaps its own impossibility. And in fact, one of the things that interests me far more about this installation is the extent to which it brings out a productive sense of chaos. That said, utopia is a word that you have used and which obviously has a very specific history. Maybe you could talk about why you use that word, or if not, or if it's a helpful type of word to use in this installation.
Well, it's very curious because, for instance, there's like this philosopher, John Gray, that wrote a book called Black Mass, and he speaks that there's a problem with utopia. And I'm talking, you know, there can maybe like leftist utopias like communism or right-wing utopias like extreme capitalism, or et cetera, that the problem is that when they're exported and there's like this kind of imposition, no? Because no one wants to live in someone else's utopia. The problem is precisely when utopia is taken as a blueprint for how society has to work. So what I believe is that if there's an utopian drive, there has to be a utopia that has a built-in mechanism that prevents any kind of tyranny. No, so you have, you know, like some things that are kind of flexible, where there's like that's a kind of democratic structure. No. And also there's like elements of utopias that are failed utopias, but that nevertheless capture your people's imagination because there's elements of that are interesting, not like Charles Fourier idea of the phalanx theory or for instance utopias such as Vasco de Quiroga in Mexico that created these hospitals that were you know like schools for different crafts, etc. So, or I don't know, like in the United States, you could talk about Drop City or, you know, like many utopias that were emerged in the 60s, which were, you know, like had moments that were brilliant and probably they were not sustainable. But you know, like there's an element of romanticism that you may, you know, like take one part of it. So I believe that utopias have elements that, I mean, perhaps not work as a whole, but that have elements that they're valuable and that can be rescued.
One of the utopias which shares the name with this project, and which is of special interest, perhaps, is the Monte Verita in Switzerland, which was a sanatorium which came out of a bohemian avant-gardist sort of trajectory and hosted people like Isadora Duncan, Paul Klee. It also had a radical civic element in terms of proposing a ban on clothing, a ban on marriage. It's something that you've talked about a little bit as an inspiration for this project. What was it particularly about that sanatorium that has resonance and meaning to you for this project?
It's curious because, you know, I learned about Monte Verita through Harold Seaman. the famous curator. He came to Mexico in the 90s, and I had the privilege of attending a week-long seminar with him. And he spoke about the exhibition he had curated about Monte Verita, which was very crucial for the development of the avant-garde movements of the 20th century, such as Bauhaus, etc. No? So, I believe that also that one thing that is interesting about Monte Verita, as well as other kind of utopian communities, was the idea of art and health. So they were doing all this kind of, they were nudists. They would like do this kind of choreographies, and they were very much about like naked, like doing dance naked in the forest and eating vegetables only, and it's a kind of a very, very early idea of hippies, but doing at the same time like kind of a concrete art, no? So, it's one of the many kind of references that can be listed.
Speaking of this sort of confluence of health and art and the hippies, to what extent did you, in defining the parameters of this project, think about the pervasiveness of language around sort of new age health lifestyles? And to what extent did you, it seems to me that something that you deliberately sort of circumscribed or avoided or protested, perhaps because it has a sort of a consumerist connotation, but maybe you could talk a little bit about that and your work vis-a-vis what is popularly understood as sort of a creative health lifestyle. Does that make sense? The extent to which you were looking at New Age philosophers, for instance, and the pervasiveness of that type of language, and particularly this sort of idea of an instructional manual that would accompany sort of self-betterment along the lines of artistic creation and health.
For instance, the thing is that I am extremely, when it comes to references, I'm extremely, you would say, promiscuous. You know, like I may flirt with any kind of things. No? You know, like I read a lot of anthropology, psychology, theater, art, etc. But you know, like if I'm researching about rituals, you know, like sometimes there's some stuff that is esoteric that goes through my hands, etc. So I mean, what I'm against is not, like, I'm not against any particular school, but what I'm against is that the problem is that I believe that the problem with, you know, like, whether you are a Sufi or a yogi or a Buddhist or you name it, is that you have to subscribe to a system of belief. And then it's like subscribing to one system of belief or one guru, whether it's Freud or is, you know, like Nietzsche or is any kind of a guru, is that it can, when the problem that is that when it cancels the possibility of having access to other knowledge, no? So that's when it's dogmatic. And in a way, you know, like I think that the sanatorium, what it does is that it's like taking elements from many, 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 many places. So, you know, like we just add a new therapy but there's no belief system. You know, it has all these references to existing techniques. So I would not say that there cannot be elements of value to be found in New Age, because you're not new, who knows what New Age is? Like it may be like an extremely big umbrella that is just like a section on the bookshop, no? And there are things that perhaps are 3,000 years old that are, you know, like may be found in that section of the bookshop, no? So, there are things that, the problem is when you have to stick to one school of thought.
Now, in terms of this project, I thought it would be appropriate for us to turn it over to our spectactors. Is there anything that we missed that you think we should talk about before we turn over to questions? Good?
Questions.
Should we open? Mari, would you like to be here to open to questions, or is she here? Oh, yeah. You don't have to MC. I can MC. Don't worry about it. Anyone can raise their hand if they'd like to ask any questions for Pedro.
Since I have not seen this particular project, but I've seen several other projects of Pedro's that I find absolutely fascinating, I'd like to ask a question about the project you did at the Queen's Museum about the UN, the project that you did at the Cultural Center Banco do Brasil in São Paulo and in Belo Horizonte. And so if you could tell us, I realize you don't have the slides for that, but I found those projects absolutely fantastic.
Well, I may have to be brief about those, but I mean, the People's United Nations that you saw at Queens is basically kind of a temporal or like a conference where our goal was to identify one delegate for every country. There's 180 countries in the world, so there was one person appointed 6 months trying to, like, which identified like these 180 delegates that got together in the museum to work one weekend on a series of activities. And that project will travel now to Los Angeles and to the Hammer Museum. So January 21st is gonna open. And in May, we're gonna do the second summit, also bringing people from, you know, well, people are mostly are residents of LA, but it's basically a conference where one representative for every country in the world takes part in this big encounter game, no? And the other that you saw in Belo Horizonte and Rio and Sao Paulo, which after Belo Horizonte will go to Brasilia, is a group of mechanized instruments, musical instruments made out of weapons, that is part of 7,000 weapons that were destroyed in order to make instruments, and there's other group of instruments that are played by musicians as well. So it's part of, you know, a series of projects that deal with the issue of how to change the perception. Well, you know, try to bring awareness about the problem of weapon trade. It's a kind of, the problem with weapon trade.
Use weapons in a different way.
And well, the idea is to turn an agent of death into an agent of life, no? And also, it's a way to say that, well, there's all these weapons that are sent into Mexico, and to turn them into musical instruments is also kind of the idea that if you can transform the metal, then there can be like a kind of also a psychological transformation and hopefully a social transformation.
Thank you.
Hi. So I feel like our country kind of has an obsession with credentials, meaning success, and really having to be trained and being really professional. So I think this is an interesting project. And I'm wondering if you've ever had any trained mental health professionals volunteer to be part of the project. And if not, how you would feel about them being volunteers.
I mean, I have a lot of extremely prepared friends that have, you know, like are authorities in their own field that I consult with. So, you know, for instance, my friend Mel Buchlotz, who's a kind of Ericksonian therapist, helped me develop one of the therapies, Antanas Mokous, who was philosopher and who's a philosopher and mathematician, crafted the vaccine against violence. It's kind of the one therapy that I didn't invent it, but it was all his invention. But it's somehow based also in another kind of a therapy called Primal Scream that was inspired by Rafael Montañez Ortiz, who was another artist. So all these therapies have like kind of genealogies, and I have consulted with several artists and the psychologists about them, the therapies, if conducted by a specialist, they don't necessarily have they would not have a better outcome, you know. It's like for instance, like once the rules of football or the rules of chess they haven't changed much, and obviously you can be a better football player and a better chess player, but that doesn't mean that the rest of the people won't have fun doing it also, no? You know, like, so the idea is that, you know, like, to come up with kind of games that produce insights, and those insights are useful for the person who are doing the activity, and all of them are equally valuable. So that's why, you know, like when the moment that they're already running, you don't need anyone to have a special skill. However, the knowledge of specialists is very useful when it comes to developing something, not developing one technique that can become, you know, a new one, I think.
Thank you.
Is there anything that people have had to, because I know, for instance, in the past, you've had sort of, the team has taken on a team leader because that person will have some kind of training that allows them to communicate the project to the others perhaps better. Is there any specific type of unlearning in those cases that people have had to do, or different types of modes of address that those highly trained individuals have had to either use or not use when dealing with visitors to the installation?
Well, I mean, it's, you know, precisely the idea is that you have to let the person who's doing the therapy, the patient, so to speak, do the interpretation. So there may be persons who feel that they have capacity to interpret, but actually, in the training, I asked them to kind of resist the temptation to interpret, because that's the work that the person will do, no? So in that sense, even if you feel that you are better equipped to help, you have to resist that temptation to a certain degree. You just have to, you know, perhaps ask a question or something, but not go on into, you know, like saying, what do you think that the person is doing? Because the therapy is not doing that you're doing onto something. The therapy is not something that you are doing onto someone. You're doing it with them, but not onto them.
I'm sorry? Oh, sure. Hi there. Well, first of all, I just wanted to say this is one of the most interesting hours I've had in a while. This has just been absolutely fascinating. When you're choosing your volunteers, do you primarily look at them on an individual basis, or do you look at them as, let's say, the therapeutic team approach?
Well, to be honest, you know, like the selection of the volunteers has happened before my arrival, because that's you know, the institution often has a human resources or outreach person that places the call. So the moment I arrive, I am only responsible for the training.
The type and sort of learning about the types of people who gravitate toward this project is an inherently interesting procedure. Also because this project attracts a lot of artists and also students and really pushes people to learn new communication skills. That's a really exciting thing to watch happen, particularly in the first few days of the installation, because they continue to learn as the installation is moving forward.
But that said, you know, after 50 installments of the project, I have probably trained about 300 volunteers, and we have treated about, we have conducted individual therapies with over 20,000 people, but the volunteers, you know, they come from very different backgrounds. You know, some people are retired therapists that miss giving therapy, which is beautiful because they can bring a lot of value, and then also art students, social workers, people from the esoteric world also, you know, like palm readers and people like that. So, you know, it's always very surprising to find all the different,
I wanted to ask Pedro about the newsletter. A couple years ago when you did the project at the Bass Art Museum, you were like handing out a newsletter that I guess you put out periodically. Are you still doing that project?
Maybe you're talking about the Atlas of Civic Innovation or something like that? It was like a newspaper?
No. It was like 8.5 by 11, like stapled together, kind of a newsletter. And you said that you were putting it out periodically, meaning I guess at random intervals. Yeah, you were handing them out during the Bass installation.
I never done like something periodically, but I remember that on occasion of that show there was a little booklet that was made.
Oh, and it was just for that show.
Uh-huh, yes.
Okay, thanks.
Welcome.
Well, thank you. Thank you, Pedro, for being here.
Thank you.
Thank you for doing this first show. Congrats.
Welcome.